Hello friends, I'm Paul Shinn. Welcome back to the Boomerist Car Channel. This is Dad. This is Bob Guimarin. He is a Model A expert in every sense of the word and has taught me 99.9% of what I know about Model A's. And just to prove how generous I am with all of our friends, I'm going to share him with you today. So last week we posted a quick video asking for some questions, and in I think it was up for about 12 hours. We got 50 questions in 12 hours, and we had to take it down before we caused the internet to break. So he is now logged into the ModelAtechquestions@gmail.com right here. So you can ask questions of him in that way too. And we've answered, what was it? I looked at last night. It was 270 something questions we've answered so far as a team. It's going quite great. So anyway, here are the questions in YouTube's order. I did not arrange them myself. This is the way YouTube did it when I printed them out. Are you ready?
Let her rip.
All right, with all that out of the way. Riley Smith asks, what is your take on the line between restoration and hot rodding? You've recommended an overdrive and high compression head in the past, along with a swapping the stock brakes to cast iron. I'm curious where you draw the line.
Well, all of those things do not deteriorate from the standard Model A. None of it is hot rodding, as you would say, but all they are is refinements of the Model A as it came out originally.
So where do you draw the line?
I do a lot of things internally that don't show. Like I put seals where there was not seals, like in the transmission and in the steering box. I put bearings and seals inside. But all I feel is that is nothing but improving the operation of a standard Model A.
Right. So no V8s,
No V8s and flatheads.
Yeah. Okay, Kent Wolf writes, I don't have any questions, but wanted to express my appreciation for the two of you for what you're doing to increase interest in the hobby of owning a Model A. Blessings.
Thank you.
That was nice. Thank you, Kent. Craig Roberts, thank you so much for sharing your knowledge. I have a 30 coupe that seems to have every quirk that a Model A can have. The biggest inconvenience is the steering and its tendency to wander all over the road. Nothing seems obviously worn and the gearbox is not overly loose. I'd love a tutorial on troubleshooting the front end. Where do you start on that?
Well, the first thing I do is I jack up the front end, keep it a little level, and I check and make sure that the kingpins are not worn. And by you take your wheel and grab it from the top and the bottom and shake it this way. If you got any shake, you got to replace the kingpin bushings and repair that. I check all of the knuckles where the piece is hooked together and where it has the screw washer like that fits inside, and make sure that they're tight enough so that when you turn the steering wheel, you watch and put your finger on every one of those things at a time and see if there's any play between the ball that goes into the socket and the spring that goes on it. If you take care of that and the kingpins, you should have a good front end.
Awesome.
Also, I'll be doing a video on how to make sure your front axle is straight, because I've seen so many. And you have too, I'm sure. If you see a Model A, they throw a chain around the front of the axle and start pulling it. Well, that axle will bend. Uh-huh. In fact, there was a picture that Henry Ford did where he took the axle, just a straight axle, put it in a lathe, and turned it 9 times. That twisted that axle like a corkscrew, and it didn't break, it just twisted it. So those things are made that way. So make sure your front axle is true.
And be on the lookout for his video on how to check your front axle.
Yeah, we'll have one coming up.
Coming up, right after alternators and right after
a couple other things.
Rob M. writes, hello once again, Paul and Bob. Rob here from Ontario, Canada. That way, hi.
Yeah.
I've stumbled upon a problem with my winter project, getting a friend's new to him 29 two-door back on the road. It seems really weak, especially in third. I've reset the timing twice. However, I'm really seeing power loss, especially noticeable on a hill compared to other Model A's. In fact, on a steep hill, I can smell a little unburnt gas as well. I believe all four cylinders are firing. I currently suspect electrical. The points are darn near worn out, and the gap is far too small at an initial glance here. Uh-huh, there's a clue. I'll be replacing, setting the points to 020 and plug gap to 035. However, I'm wondering if I might also be a bad or incorrectly installed coil. Could be backwards.
Could be backwards.
I heard that if the coil is wired backwards, it could really be causing me grief. Yes. Any tips on how to test the coil with basic tools? Thanks.
Well, first thing I do is a coil is actually two sets of wiring inside. One wire hooks to both of them, and the other two terminals hooks to, one of them has a very low ohm reading. If you take an ohm meter and you read one side of it, you'll get maybe 2 or 3 ohms, and the other side you might get up to, I'd say 1,000 to 3,000 ohms. But that'd be the way I check a coil.
And then you got to make sure it's wired properly.
Yeah, make sure it's wired properly.
Polarity.
But you sound like you got a major problem that I don't want to tell you about it, but I guess it better.
You're going to talk about cam timing, aren't you?
No, I'm going to talk about flywheels.
Oh, yes.
Now, originally Ford came out with a 62-pound flywheel. And everybody thought, oh, my goodness, let's take that. And they take them and they turn them down, some of them down to 30 to 40 pounds. And when they start up that hill, all the others run off and leave you because you lose your inertia. And that thing slows down while everybody else. I leave all my flywheels at 62 pounds and don't have a problem up here in this high country.
And a lot of people, they think that because they add counterweights to the crank that they have to lighten the flywheel. And that's not true, because when Henry Ford added counterweights to the Model B crank, he still left the flywheel
right, all full the
weight.
Same.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's a good point. A lot of people overlook that. David G.N. Coley writes, two questions, edit as needed. Back in 1973, I was 14 and crazy about Model A's. My parents bought me a basket case 29 roaster for $350. Mm-hmm. Restoring the rusty leaf springs, I dismantled, sanded, primed, and painted them. And following the advice of Rick's Model A restoration manual, I put a strip of Teflon tape between the leaves. Was this appropriate?
Nope. Never use that stuff, because all I do is if I take them apart and clean them in, sandblast them, prime and paint them all, I just put a little grease in between them and let it rip. And it works fine. 20 years later, it's still that way.
Well, you just walked right into the second question. What is the best way to grease springs, and how was this done back in the day?
He didn't do anything. He just put them together.
Yeah, they did. But you can grease the springs after the fact, can't you?
Yeah, if you can take them out of the car and kind of lay them on the side and let the grease flow down in it.
Do you have to heat them or anything?
No, just let it soak. But when I build a spring, I put grease in between them, and that 20 years later,
that still works.
It's still working in there. No squeaks yet.
Yep. Lee Kaiser writes, I love your channel. I don't have a Model A yet, but you inspired me to get one. Yay, another one. I learned that some people change over to 12-volt systems, and I know you prefer 6-volt, as I would too, because it's more original. What are the pros and cons of negative ground and positive ground?
Well, Henry Ford used negative ground on all of his cars all the way up to about 39, somewhere along in the around the 40s. But anyway, he used 6-volt batteries all the way up into 54.
Yeah.
But it's nothing wrong. It's actually... some of the other manufacturers used positive ground also back in the 20s. The only thing that would be advantage is corrosion seems to build on the negative side instead of the positive. I mean, so that by putting positive ground, that corrosion seems to work on the negative side also. So therefore, you clean it a lot easier. But if you put a good ground in it and things like that, when these people take the pans off the engine pans, they've lost the ground between the frame and the engine. So we put a big wire between the battery terminal on the frame around to the terminal on the back of the bell housing there, and we've eliminated a lot of the problems.
Yeah, in fact, recently somebody wrote in the ModelAtechquestions@gmail.com, mm-hmm. and he said that he got his Model A running, but the spark advance rod and the tube, the vacuum tube that goes between the manifold mm-hmm. and the firewall was hot. after cranking the engine, because he didn't have a ground. That was providing the ground.
That was the ground through there.
And the starter's drawing 800 amps or something.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's why.
Yeah.
Interesting. Jay O'Neill writes, hey guys, I'm looking forward to another Q&A. My question is, were the tops on closed Model A's, why were they so complex? Was there some manufacturing advantage to Ford in the multi-layered soft design?
Well, that soft top was used all the way up for years after that. But when they started building the Model A, they all came in pieces. If you look at a 29 Model A, like a two-door or a coupe or something, that back panel and the two side panels are bolted together. So if he'd have tried to make that with a solid top on it, he'd had a big chunk there that he'd had a heck of a time trying to make in a mold.
Yeah.
So by using that canvas top, it's a lot cheaper, lightweight, a lot easier to do. And it really was helping him when he was building the side panels and the back panels on the coupes and two doors and stuff like that.
That's right. Eagle One writes, hey, Bob and Paul. First, thanks for doing this. I have a 1928 Model A two-door that I've enjoyed for 4 years, but now it won't start, and I'm sure it's because I listened to someone telling me to use lead additive, and so she sits. I pulled the plugs before rolling her into the garage for the winter, and it's like they are caked with grease. What can I do? Please help.
Well, first thing I would do, I'd get me some Marvel mystery oil.
Good idea.
And I put down into those cylinders. And then I crank it a little bit and make sure it gets all that in there. And additives in the gasoline are not buying you nothing, except to keep a stabilizer will keep it keep the gasoline from mixing, from
separating,
and it keeps it mixed while it's sitting in the winter. But it's just a stabilizer is all it is. But we use whatever gas that we can get that's the cheapest.
In California, we're stuck with corn gas. We can't.
Yeah, but my Model A will run on anything from vodka to brandy.
Yes, and it's been proven.
Yep, it's been proven.
Thank you, Sonny. Victorian Ladd writes, hello, grace and peace to you both. I was curious if the Model A leatherbacks, almost like this, would be considered a more rare car compared to the majority of Model A's on the road today. Obviously not the rarest body style, but more rare than styles like coupes, two doors, trucks, four doors, and so on, as they did not make very many compared to the rest. I have a 29 leatherback sedan. You don't seem to come across many of them on the road. God bless.
Yeah, they're a little desirable, but because they're a little, they didn't make as many of them. That's the only thing.
Right, right.
And you can go back to some of the manuals and they'll tell you how many was produced for each model per year. And they're like, the two-door sedan, it was probably the most popular car there was.
By far, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot more of them made. The business coupe, like I have in 29, there was 36,000 made in 29, I think around 35,000 in 28, but they didn't make that car in 30, 31. So you would just have to go back and find out from one of the manuals or judging standards and stuff like that. We'll give you the idea of percentages.
Yeah, it's not exactly rare, but you don't see them a lot.
You don't see too many of them. Mm-hmm. We've got two in our club.
Yeah, at least.
I think it's only two.
Is it? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Jeff C. writes, hi, Bob and Paul. My question concerns valve stem hardware for inner tubes. I've never installed the metal stems. I've always just ran the rubber stem tubes. Do you have any tricks for a novice to make this easier?
Well, originally they came out with metal stems, like the mail truck and those that come with them. And what they did nowadays, what I do, is I get a new tube, I'll take and cut that stem off right at the top of the, where it comes out of the tube, so that there's like a little knob like there, and I cut it off right there. And then I soap it good, and I take the metal stem and I turn it sideways and in there until you get it all the way down in there, and then it'll pull back around it, and then you put the seal on it, and then you do that, and then you put it in the car, and then you put the cap on it. But that one seal comes over the top of the stem on the outside of the rim, so that holds the tube and everything tight in the rim. And then there's a cover that goes over that for looks.
Is there any gotchas he should watch out for?
Cutting it too thin.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that I would say.
So leave a little bit of a
Wherever it sticks out, it looks like there's a little hump there where it's molded.
That's just, okay then.
Yeah, just cut it off right there above that.
No.
And just use soap. I just use a little soap in there to get that, turn it sideways and kind of work it in, and it'll finally, you'll get it in there and make sure it's in there even all the way around, and then you can put that seals on it, or screw seals.
Awesome. Great Mist writes, I just want to let you know that as a millennial, I never had shop class and never learned how to pack grease or anything about cars. Thanks for being my teacher. Hey, good job. Mm-hmm. I have a question on the lifespan of 6-volt battery running LED lights and possibly a cell phone, or is there an answer, always install an alternator, question mark?
Well, we install alternators because of, well, let's have a little history then. If you have a early powerhouse generator, which they came out in 28, they didn't keep them very long. There was problems with them. So they went to a regular generator and a cutout on the top. The cutout is nothing but a one-way switch, a relay, which opens and closes. And when the engine's running and the battery is lower than the generator output, then it closes the relay and it fills it up, the charging rate. When it's full, the relay opens. Well, over a period of time, that relay opens and closes, and pretty soon those points will stick together. You don't know it till the next day when you try to start the car and you got a dead battery, because they close them points and it'll run that battery all the way down. So we put alternators in. But another thing about a generator that you don't think about, a generator, you have to change the current rating of that generator from day to night. In the daytime, you only want to charge about 2 amps. At night, you want to charge full 20 amps. And to do that, you have to take the band off the generator, run that third brush all the way around to the top there until it's charging 20 amps. And then you forget it. And the next day, you go to town and you're running around and all of a sudden your battery's
boiled it out.
Yeah. Yep. But another thing too, if you got it set on 20 and you blow the fuse that you have installed in there, that generator now is putting out between 20 and 25
volts
and all the current it can use. And there goes your lights, there goes your horn, there goes your coil. So there's no free lunch there. You have to decide. So we all go to alternators, which has a built-in regulator. And the only thing I have to do on that alternator is I put an internal jumper, which I'll show in the video that when we're going to do alternators. And that you have to turn your, when you start your engine, you got to run it up to about 900 to 1,000 RPMs, and you'll notice your amp meter kicks and then starts back down. That means an alternator has been excited and it's charging. And that's the only thing you have to do is make sure that thing, run the altmeter up. But that's the only thing about the alternator you have to worry about.
I remember on the way home from Nevada when the fuse blew in your sport coupe and it ran for a long time. And then I remember coming up behind you and I seen you guys on the side of the road and pulled over. That's all. And the fuse fell out. We still never found the fuse.
But yeah.
Remember that?
Worked loose.
It did. Oh, that was amazing. Alex Enns writes, I've always wanted a Model A and really want to get a project car. What are some things to look out for in getting one that needs work?
How much work do you want to do?
Yeah, right?
You're going to pay for, there's no, like I say, there's no free lunch on this one either. You're going to buy a car. You can buy them all the way from $1,000, $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, or $20,000, or $30,000. With a $5,000 or $500 car, you got more work to do on it than you do on a $1,000. So it's what you're capable of doing. If you're able to do engine work and do all the other body work and upholstery and painting and all that kind of stuff, get one that's nothing and go from there. But if you can't do this, get one that's a little more together so that you can do the things that you can do.
We always suggest getting a running, driving Model A for your first
one. I would suggest get it for you, starting out new, you don't know what you want yet, go find one that's running. You might pay a little more than you think, but get it, you drive it, while you find one that you want to your ultimates. You say, my ultimate car I want. And then you find that in a basket case, and you have a car to drive while you're building this one, and you won't lose interest.
And you'll be learning off that car,
yeah,
too.
I've bought four cars from one fella that he started and never finished. He gave up. So get one that's running, and then get the car of your dream and build it up.
Get your feet wet first. Mm-hmm. All right, Ian Thornton writes, is there a large supply of aftermarket parts to boost the power for the Model A?
Yes. You can do it in any way you want to do it. The way I do it would be, I would, it depends on how much you want to spend too. I take and have my cams ground to what we call a touring grind or B-cam grind, one of those. That gives me more lift, and my duration is longer for the fuel to get into it. Now, like the valve of a Model A comes up, let's say, and it's around 307 thousandths. With a Model B grind, it goes up to about 337. So that 37 up is puts more fuel into the thing, gives you more power. And you can put a Model B carburetor in there, and you have to modify your intake manifold. The B carburetor has an inch and an eighth throat. The Model A carburetor is an inch and a sixteenth. So you've got about a sixteenth of an inch all the way around that you need to. So I mill out the manifold to take that carburetor, and that gives me more fuel, and it runs a lot hotter, or as you say, or faster, or whatever you want to call it.
It breathes better.
Yeah, it breathes better. And you can do that. I use a C-head, which is a 5-to-1. You can go all the way up to a, well, don't they have about a 6-something, 6-2 or 6-7?
Snyder sells a 6.1-to-1.
Yeah, 6-1. Or you can get their 5-3 or something.
I think it's a 5-5.
So you can get two or three heads. It's made by Snyder, Brumfield, and all them. And you're going to boost your power that way. You know, there are just a million little ways to do it. And it depends on how much you want to spend and how fast you want to go.
Yep. I'm sorry, your head more?
But I was just going to say, in our club, we only drive as fast as the slowest car in the club.
Which is Karn's.
Yeah.
Terry Dublin writes, I'm interested in getting a truck. I was told to try and find a 3031. What is the difference between the 2829 versus the 3031, and which do you prefer?
Well, if I was going to get a double A, they call them.
He just wants a regular truck.
A pickup?
Yeah.
Oh, a pickup. I would go 3031, mainly because between 28 and 30, Ford made a lot of changes in the car. His radiators is about 2 inches taller, so you got more cooling. He went from a Model T body to a Model A body in 30, what we call
it. More rounded, I guess.
Yeah, it's around, before we called them square backs.
Mm-hmm.
And he just made a lot more improvements in it, and so I like the 3031s.
Yeah, and the 2829s, you sit like this.
It's a straight back.
And the 3031s, you sit about like this.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's quite a bit of difference in room and inside.
A lot more comfortable.
Yeah. Jim Alessi writes, Hi, Paul. The fuse keeps blowing on my 31 Deluxe Roadster. What are some tips and tricks for locating the shorts?
Well.
Start with the headlight buckets.
Yeah, that's most generally is where those plugs go in the headlights buckets. That's a real problem there. There was three. If the lights are, you have two light bulbs in your headlight, you have three wires in there, high, low, and what we used to call parking lights. But anyway, and those terminals in there are spring loaded, and they can twist real easy. And a lot of times they're short out.
Hey, this is Gary.
Yeah.
That's Gary.
So anyway, I would check that first.
And then the light wafer, the switch. Gary's having trouble with the ladder.
Yeah.
It's just YouTube. It's okay.
I've been in the berries too long.
It's just YouTube.
Yeah.
Bon Franklin writes, should I stick with rope seal or use neoprene donut on the crankshaft?
Oh, shit, I didn't get your shoes.
Yeah, we're still shooting.
Yeah, go ahead.
Gary's part of the podcast now.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. It's all right.
I would use neoprene because it's a lot easier to use. I'm lazy. And Terry Burke made that seal, and it works perfect, even though the price has gone sky high.
Way high.
But the only problem is, if you put one in the car that's running, you got to lower the pan, take that old donut out, is the proper word to use right in, on video. and the same way with your timing cover, you have to lift it and take that one out. Then you have to take your crankshaft pulley off, mm-hmm, and slide the donut round like a donut into the system, onto the shaft. Then you got to put your pan back on and your timing cover back on. But if you got the engine apart, boy, it's sure the nice way to do it,
isn't it?
Yep.
I still use rope seals, I guess.
Well, I do because when I'm too lazy to.
Yeah.
But you got to make sure you cut them right and don't get them too thin. And what I do is on those rope ones, I keep a couple in a can out here in oil.
Soaking.
They've been soaking in oil so that when I get them in there, they've already been saturated and I can bend them and cut them off like the. And
yeah, that's the best idea right there. But. All right. Rob M. says, Bob and Paul, a more comical question, also coming from Ontario. Oh, he knows the other guy in Ontario, I guess.
Yeah.
But only if you have time. Between my friend Ken and I, we now have four Model A's. You guys are just starting. As well as my late grandfather's two Model T's. Needless to say, our wives are very unimpressed. I'm certain that you have had those conversations in the past, having the 14 or so cars between the two of you. Any advice on what we can say to our loving spouses, Renata, I guess it is, and Joanna, to reinforce how special these old Fords are?
Well, you know what my wife says? What? Keeps them off the street and out of the bars.
That's true, right? I told my wife I would keep the cars in my half of the property. That was pretty much it. Yeah.
Well, that's the way it is at my house here. My wife has a front yard and a house. Yeah. I have a backyard and a garage. And she badmouths me about my junk, and I tell her about her weeds out front that she calls flowers.
The house is a Mason-Dixon line.
Yes,
so she's the Yankee.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And she doesn't come over onto this side.
Yeah.
So anyway, there's, I can't tell you any advice on that. There's no
it's, they've got to either tolerate it or love it.
Yeah.
Now, another thing too, the more you drive it, and don't put them in the back seat, put them in the front seat. Let them ride with you.
Yeah.
And go on to the grocery store or to someplace. You know, start using it more.
Like a car.
Like a regular car. Then they'll get used to it and tolerate it more.
Much more.
And then if you belong to a club and they start going on outings where she can meet with other women and families, then she will be more tolerant of you having them.
That's a fact. Good one. That's good advice. Hastings Siegfried writes, love your work on the channel. Just sent donation. Oh, thank you, Hastings. Appreciate that. Richard Fitzgibbon writes, it's a good idea to install a battery cutoff switch, and where is the best location?
Well, a lot of people put them here, there, and everywhere. But if you're going to put one on, which I don't see anything wrong with them, I think they're pretty nice, I would put one right on the floorboards under the driver's seat, right there where you can reach down and get it. I don't like the ones where you have to open the hood to get it to it and all that. But I think right under the driver there, right on the wood floorboard there, and just put it right there where you won't kick it and you can get in and out of the car without bumping it.
And stepping on it and all that.
Yep.
The guy, Paw T, the guy who turned us on to the mail truck in there, he writes, hello, gents. Is the Model A metal body thick enough to be restored after a fire? Sand blast, dry ice blast, soda blast, dip,
yes,
question mark?
Yes, both of them I've seen are. Some of them, though, have been warped. And like, for instance, I had a two-door that had been warped in the panels. And so it took me a little bit to figure out how to shrink the metal, but it can be done. And what it did was, like, there was a dent there that every time I try to take it out, it would bend, go the other way or something, you know, because it was stretched so much. And I would heat it up real red hot and throw cold water on it, and it would shrink it. So you can shrink places like that. And but most generally, a fire doesn't hurt that metal that bad. If it gets it that bad, it's going to melt part of it.
That's true. But I hope you didn't have a fire, Paul.
Yeah, but not. Yeah, but like I say, I've seen a lot of them where I bought ones that have been in fires, and I've been able to repair them.
Jeff H. writes, I have a 1931 four-door slant window. My horn seems to work intermittently. All the electrical leads to the horn seem fine, and I suspect the contacts and the button on the steering wheel are to blame. That's pretty much normal. Is there a way to check that?
Well, if the horn is wired up hot all the time, and the other wire, it goes from the horn, the ground wire, if you want to call it that, or the positive, or whichever side you want to put it, but the cold side.
The cold side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It goes from the horn down to the light switch in the bottom of your steering column, and that's a spring-loaded piece there. Goes all the way up to the horn.
Runs all the way up.
To the top. And then when you push the button, it grounds it over there, and it goes all, the ground goes all the way down the shaft on the outside now to the housing and out and somewhere to ground. Now, if you want the ultimate.
You cheat though.
Yeah, if you want the ultimate, I would put a relay, a little relay. I put one right underneath the frame there. And the relay is a 6-volt relay, just like used to be in cars, horn relays. And that horn relay will close at anywhere from 4 to 7 volts. Well, I got a positive ground now for the horn. And so when that relay closes, that horn has a direct ground.
Right to the frame, right
there. Right there on the frame. And so it eliminates all the bad parts of the horn rod up through the column.
As long as you can pass a little current through that, it'll close that relay.
Yeah, it don't take much. If, like I say, if horn's only getting 4 volts before, it'll run that relay. And in fact, you can buy relays to put in the horn, yeah. But you have to rewire some part of the horn to get it to work.
Yep, kind of a pain. Mm-hmm. Patrick writes, hey Paul, Patrick again, I'm having a door window issue, on my 29 AA dump truck. What is the best way to clip the weather stripping window channel to the sides? Do you cut the stripping or let it run long into the door?
Well, I put new stripping in. There's a little hook on the top that you hook it into.
Yeah, it goes right on the edge.
And then it goes all the way down and hooks on the bottom. And that's pretty tight when you're a new one. Mm-hmm. So I soap them. We just take a bar of soap like you get next time you go to the motel, grab a couple of bars of soap.
Yeah, they're free.
And they're about 1/4 to 3/8 inch wide.
They're perfect.
And I just run them up and down the doors. I don't even wet them unless I'm just enough to, you know, get them damp. And run them up and down those doors, and I've had no more problem.
Yeah, that works really good. That's a good tip. James Sorensen writes, hey, Paul, since you've dipped your toes in the waters of controversy by engaging the oil debate a couple videos ago, where do you stand on carburetors? Zenith, Tillotson, Marvel, or whichever happens to be on the car and will run? I've recently been won over by Marvel after struggling quite some time with a handful of Zenith to get any degree of consistency out of them, but I almost feel like an outsider as I see so few cars running them in my region. Go!
This is a dandy one. I've been down that road.
He's been
anyway,
building.
I built 34 carburetors at one time.
Yeah.
I got a lot of problems with carburetors, and I think I've solved most of them.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing that you find with a Zenith is where the GAV valve goes in, or to most people, the choke rod goes down. There is 4 passages for that. And one of them goes up to the front bowl, one of them goes sideways. If you turn the carburetor over, you'll see a little bump there where that channel is. And it goes over to the plug that goes on the bottom of the carburetor and it goes into a jet there. That thing is crooked and they always clog up. And if you got that one clogged up, you're never going to get it, but you got it, you don't know it because you can blow air through all the others. So if you got to clean that out, and I've had a little problem cleaning it out, but I've found out that I can do it.
And that's the lowest point of the carburetor too.
That's true. So anyway, that's 90% of the problem. People don't understand that one little passageway has to be perfectly clean.
And that goes down to the cap jet?
Yep, it goes every which way.
Every which way?
Yep.
So Zenith, Tillets, and Marvel, what do you think of those three?
I use all Zenith, nothing else. I've had a Marvel. In fact, I think it's laying around here in the pile somewhere.
It was over there somewhere.
It's over in the pile somewhere.
The Tillotson's gone to trash.
Tillotson is a good carburetor, but they're made out of aluminum, and they have a tendency to warp. And you can never get them sealed, and that's sucking air. Mm-hmm. Therefore, you're never getting your right mixture coming up through the throat.
When they run good, but the problem is they stop.
Yeah, they leak.
Yeah, you'll be out somewhere and now, it warps this much and then...
And so that takes us back to when Ford was going to build the Model A. The Zenith design one, which would look like a Tillotson, had three bolts to hold it together. Ford says, nope, I only want one bolt holding that thing together. So they came back with another carburetor that had two bolts holding it. He says, nope, one. O-N-E, one. So they came back, but they had to have a casting now. They couldn't do it with aluminum. So they came out with a cast bolt. He said, that's what I wanted, a cast iron carburetor and a one bolt holding it. And so now the Zenith is just like he wanted it.
Yep, they were good.
There's three different models.
Oh, there's...
Well, yeah. There's 100 different models, but...
They got to see your Zenith carburetor video.
Yeah.
I'll put a link to that in the description there.
Yeah.
That's where you talked about the different types of carbs and what years.
Right.
That was a good one. That was a good video. Scott Chadbourne writes, I recently bought my first Model A 1930 coupe. Good for you. Right, good. It's all your fault, he says.
Uh-oh.
Spark plugs number 3 and 4 are getting very soaked when I try to start it. I turn the choke half turn counterclockwise, close choke on first attempt to fire. Throttle just cracked, ignition fully retarded. I shut off the gas valve when I parked the car. My dad, age 93, suggests there may be a piece of debris under the float needle. This is a stock Zenith carb, by the way. Mm-hmm. Then he has another question. So what do you think about his plugs number 3 and 4 getting very soaked when he tries to start it?
That don't sound like a throat problem. I mean, a throttle.
No, it doesn't.
A float problem.
Nope.
Sounds like he's running a little rich.
Sounds like it's a lot rich, huh?
Yeah.
Or maybe he's got those reproduction jets that were way too big.
That's another thing, too. For years, all them jets came, I think, from Argentina. And they're so far out of line, I don't even use them. I go back to originals and clean them up. And I use it looks like pipe cleaners that you get to clean your tips of your acetylene torches. And they're all marked in thousands. And I use them to gauge all my jets.
Those are good. You talked about that in the carburetor.
Right. It should be. Look at the carburetor problems.
Mm-hmm. It's almost positively it's carburetor problem.
Yeah.
My water pump started leaking and the packing nut will not turn out on the shaft. I decided to remove the whole pump, order a new one as the shaft moved in and out about a half an inch. That's not bad. Mm-hmm. I noticed the impeller has ends knocked off too. Is there a way to get the fan blade, two-blade aluminum off the shaft without a gear puller? Tap it.
Yeah, you'll just have to tap it.
Bang on it.
Put a nut on it.
Put a nut so you don't booger the threads.
Yeah, I use just a regular nut. Don't use the castle nut. Use a regular nut and bring it down just within, I'd say, the hair of the thing. And hold it and get a peasant fella to hold it.
He was going to say get a peasant to hold it. I knew it.
Yeah.
And that's me. I'm the one who does the holding.
And then take a hammer and hit the center of it, and you'll jar it loose.
So with your peasant holding it,
yeah,
he has to whack it pretty hard. Don't be afraid to really give it a good whack. I knew you were going to say peasant. I could tell.
There's peasant and Paul both come the same.
Same thing. Mac Fisher, I don't have a question, but I do have a request. Bob, if it's not too much of an imposition or invasion of your privacy, could you have that great camera person, Tina, do a quick video of your garage and, dare I say, pile of goodies? From what I've seen in the background of your garage, it looks like a museum of Model A parts.
It is.
Yeah, it is.
I'll have to get Tina to do it.
Yeah, we got to get her over here. Yeah, she was over here for like a whole week.
Yeah, when we cleaned up
detailing the mail truck before Concourse. But
Well, we'd have to get a couple of cars out so you can get a view of it.
Yeah, right now you can't really
see too much.
Stuff's in the way. And not only the garage, but behind the garage, next to the garage, in front of the garage.
When people come down here, I first make them sign a release of liability. Yes. I don't want nothing falling on them.
You think he's kidding. Depose writes, the 600W oil is leaking from my differential in two places. Should I do anything about this? Number one is between the torque tube and the front of the banjo housing. Number two is the lowest bolt and the axle or banjo housing. Thank you.
Sounds like you got two gasket problems.
Yep.
Yeah. Now, the torque tube has a gasket around it. I don't think you can... I'm just don't believe you can get that gasket out without taking something loose.
We've tried.
Yeah, but
you at least have to take the wishbone loose, take the shackles loose, or something. Yeah, it's a pain.
Now, same way with the one that's leaking out of the bottom. You got to take that your rear spring loose on one side or the other, so you can separate those two from the banjo there, the two axle housings from the banjo to replace them.
It's easier to take the driver's side one off.
Yeah.
Because if you pull the driver's side, let's say you take the spring shackle on the driver's side loose, you pull the axle housing on the driver's side, you can take all the guts out the driver's side. So you can take both axles with the spider gears, the ring, everything, all comes out. You take that other axle housing off, there's nothing in your way, because you got to dry that out, because some of those bolts go all the way through.
But I tell you what I think I'd do before that. I would take those lower bolts off, Permatex them.
Oh, yeah.
And squeeze them back in there and see if that don't help you leak on the lower banjo.
At least that one.
Mm-hmm.
Good idea. Carlos Renosco writes, hi, Bob and Paul. My engine has shims under the head nuts. Is it okay to remove them one by one and torque them in the proper value? Why does he have shims? That's weird.
I think there might be washers.
Must be.
But that's a lot of people have put washers under there, but no, we take them out. That nut should go straight against that head.
Unless you got one of those race heads or something like a 7-1.
Yeah, something.
Blah, blah, blah. Because they recommend putting nuts on those because they're aluminum.
Yeah.
And they don't want to crack them or whatever.
Yeah.
Let's see. Another question he has is, I have a vacuum windshield wiper on my 28 two-door, but I saw that in the year they had windshield wipers that were electric. Is that right?
I don't know what year that was, I mean, what month that was, but it all varied. But now my 29 business coupe is September, and it still had an electric wiper on it then. But you can look it up, and the judging standards will show that. But you've got about a three-month leeway on either side for anything, because Ford didn't stop production when something run out. For instance, now, if he run out of electric wipers, it was still May or June, he put vacuum on there because he didn't stop production for anything.
No way.
In fact, I've seen some weird things happen.
Yeah, big time. Jeff Boyles writes, always trying to get my wife's buy-in on this hobby. She says riding in the back seat is like a buckboard. How can I tell whether my original shocks are even functioning? Also, how much trouble to drop the rear spring and disassemble for cleanup? It is very stiff.
Yeah. Well, you need a spring spreader.
Oh, yeah.
And a good pair of goggles. Safety glasses.
Yes. And life insurance.
Yeah. What you need to do, you're going to have to lift up the body in the back about 4 to 6 inches, take the spare tire off if it's in the back, and then you will take the spring shackles loose, and then you can remove the spring, and you can actually remove the rear end too if you want to. But you got to lift it up and take the shackles loose. And when you do, you might as well put new bushings in your shackles.
Yeah.
And press them in with, you can press them in with a vise or anything. They're not that hard. And be sure and lube them good when you put them back together.
Yes. And we've done springs before.
Yeah.
Recently we did Gazzetta's right. rear spring, and it took about a half a day.
Yeah.
And that's knowing what we're doing. So be patient. But,
and the other thing too, if you're going to take that main spring apart in the rear, you want to be careful and do slowly, go slowly, because I put two big C-clamps, one on each side of that main spring and nut in the center, so that when that nut comes loose, them springs don't go every which way and up.
You'll be the next SpaceX program.
Yeah, so be awful careful there.
Yeah, and hopefully your wife will buy in after that, after seeing you with all your space.
And another thing too, you're talking about the shocks work. The easiest way to do them is unhook them from the tube there that holds them onto the shock arm comes out, then there's a tube there that hooks to the axle and the shock.
That's a shock link.
That's the link there. Yeah. I usually take that loose and take the shock arm, or it's easier, I think I'd do it for you to do it. I would take the nut off of the shock arm. It's on the shock.
Take the arm off.
Take the arm off. You can just slide it and leave all that linkage together, because there's eight little brass washers and springs and everything.
And the cups and the,
all that.
Yeah.
So for you, I would take the arm off, take a crescent wrench, and adjust it down to that side, and you should be able to move that arm. It should be pretty tight moving both ways.
But it should move.
But it should move, but you know, you would have resistance, because inside of that you're pushing fluid from one side of the shock to another
through a small little hole.
Yeah, so I would do it that way, and that way you don't have to lose them linkages.
Good point. Asterwork, that's our friend Adrian in Germany. Oh yeah, I've got one. I don't know what that was about. He says, the serial number on my engine has been tampered with. I do wish to know the production date of my car, but I don't want to take the chassis off the frame to find out. I think he means a body off the frame.
Yeah.
However, I found a number stamped on the floor of the cabin between the floorboard and the seat bench. It says SFA and some numbers. Could that be used to date the car, or is it a serial number in any way?
That was the body number that was used by Ford, and you happen to have a body that was made in San Francisco. It should have an SFA on it.
Yeah.
If it was Atlanta, it should have an ATL, I think. And Cincinnati had two C's. Mm-hmm. And so wherever the body was assembled to the car, that's where the...
Yeah. Now, he has a five-digit SFA number, so that places him somewhere in 31.
Right.
So,
but
we don't know what month. But.
Yeah, but like I say, I would do this. It's a little... I would loosen the nuts on the body on the left side. Because what you want to look at is right, there's a bolt that goes through the body right in the front.
Right there.
That goes down through the frame. Just behind that, it's a serial number. So I would take those bolts loose and lift it up about an inch or 2 inches. And you can buy tape. And it's special, I don't know where you, CHP has it here, our highway patrol. And they can lay it in there, and he takes his finger and rubs it down smooth, takes it off, and there's the number.
The imprint, yeah.
The imprint's right on it. Or you can lift it up a little bit and take a mirror and read it.
We did it with the camera so that we could get the title for the gray Gandalf.
Right.
We lifted it and stuck an iPhone in there and went click with the flash, and then we had it.
Yep.
And we got our title. Harold Dims writes, can you explain insert bearings versus Babbitt? How an insert bearing is installed in a Babbitt engine. I'm a retired GM mechanic. I've never worked on engines that old. My knowledge goes back to the early 50s.
You young fella.
Young guy.
Yeah. Well, anyway, the Babbitt versus insert. Inserts is the ultimate, Babbitt is fine if you're going to just run a regular engine, no high-speed heads, no racing and nothing like that. The Babbitt they have today is not the Babbitt they used in 1929, 30, 31, long in there. The Babbitt they use today is called 4X Nickel, and it's what they use in Caterpillar engines.
It's hard.
It is. It, if you drop a bar of it, it rings.
Yeah.
If you drop a bar of the other Babbitt, it thuds.
Thuds.
But if you got a choice, go to inserts, because you can change them without having any more problems.
Agreed. I've gotten to the point now, I've said it so many times in these videos, I won't take a Babbitt motor if you gave it to me these days. How many have I splattered? How many Babbitt motors have I splattered? For no good reason, just minding my own business.
But you got to realize, too, that we don't drive like they used to.
That's right.
We don't think nothing of driving 45, 55 miles an hour.
All day long.
Well, in those days, they didn't have the roads to do it 45 miles an hour. A lot of their traveling was on dirt roads at 20 miles an hour all day long. And so the engine really didn't take any abuse.
One of our previous videos, you admitted to driving your sport coupe when you splattered the Babbitt in that without an overdrive. What were you doing, 70?
65 to 70. 70.
That'll do it.
And the grandson, we was going into town there, and he says, going a little fast, aren't you? And I, I guess I am.
Well, that car, you can't tell how fast you're going in that car. It's, that car's got interesting voodoo or something. Edwin Barnes writes, I have a 1930 truck with a Mallory dual point distributor installed by the previous owner. How do I set the timing?
Set the timing the same way you would anything else.
A dual point Mallory and a Model A, though.
You set the timing, but you set your distributor separately.
Right.
You have to set the points on the distributor. And I would set them at 20, and then I would set the timing. You set the timing at dead top center of whatever distributor you have.
It's still going to be the same thing then.
Yep. And I'd still use a instrument that I that so that if I didn't have the regular distributor and I had one of them fancy things, I would take it and right after you set the linkage, I mean your spark lever up, and you set it, your things at 20, and you think you got the timing right and everything, I would look at that number one hole and make sure that that piston was all the way to the top.
Yeah.
Then I would take that spark lever, and as you move it back and forth a little bit, that points should spark.
That's where the points just open.
Yeah, that's where they open and close, is at dead top center and just right there. So I would check that to make sure the spark, you get the spark just below top dead center, so you can move it back and forth and see that it's working properly.
Cool. Last page. Here we go. Dan Buckley writes, Model A Burtz engine, yes or no? Your opinion.
Yes.
We have a story.
And we have yes and no. Burt engine is...
Terry Burtz he's talking
Terry
about.
Burt engine is fabulous. And in fact, I ordered two, one for me and my grandson, not Paul. And
I had to order my own.
Yeah. But...
We just wrote a giant check, by the way.
Yeah. Was anyway, one thing led to another, and we've had problems with the... How would we say it? The fellow that...
The distribution.
Yeah, the distribution. Yeah. But we're supposed to have that problem and waiting to get one, see. But...
2 years?
Oh, I've been waiting since...
19.
2009. When he had trouble...
At the Lodi Foundry and all
at
that?
At the Lodi Foundry, yeah. Couldn't make one. So anyway, we're waiting to get them to see, but from all indications, it's going to cost you probably at least seven grand to get one built.
About that.
Because every part except the inserts, you can use Model A parts on the outside. So you got to come up with pistons, rings, and if you don't order the cam from them, you got to have your cam.
Timing gear.
You got to have
valves.
You got to have valves, valve guides, springs, keepers, pistons, rings, valve cover, both pieces of valve cover.
Timing cover.
Timing cover, pan, head. Also, you're going to have, what was the other thing that I was thinking?
The oil pump has to be...
Has to be modified. So, and another one of them cases where there's no free lunch.
No.
You're going to have between, you'll have around $7,000 in it. Right now, you can have an engine inserted for $6,000.
Completely rebuilt?
Completely rebuilt. But you got an old block, or with me, yeah. I've got a new block. I've got a couple of new 1928 blocks. It's never had a valve in them. But like I say, it's going to be expensive, but you'll have an engine that'll last you the rest of your life.
The inside of that engine would be like brand new, like yeah, modern, is. Brand new.
It is. It's going to have 14 inserts in it. You're going to have, it's a five main crankshaft. So therefore, you got to have special rods to fit.
They come with it.
But they come with it. But you have to have 14 inserts, which is a common insert that I think it would come out of a GM product that you can just go up here to the store and buy it.
Yeah, the auto parts store has those.
Yeah. And like I say, then you got to buy both pieces of the timing cover. You got to have the pan, you got to have the pulley, you got to have the nut for the front of it. The only advantage of using their camshaft is they have pre-drilled it so that when you put it in on your timing cover, there's a spring and a plunger that keeps the timing gear flush against the back.
Yeah.
So that new timing cam has a hole pre-drilled in it so that you get oil up there. But you get enough oil splash around in that thing anyway. To,
yeah, there's a big fog inside the crankcase when it's running.
And there's oil splattered all over that inside the timing cover.
Sure.
I can prove that.
Yes, yes, you can. So watch the channel here, because as soon as we get our Terry Burt's engines finally,
yeah,
then we're going to do a whole series on it. We're going to put one in a car and drive the heck out of it.
So we're going
to
show you what we have to do to put it together.
Yep, we're going to go through all that. Mm-hmm. Step one is we're going to end up having them hot tanked. That's the first step.
Yeah, we're going to clean them first. Get them a hot tank, clean them out, make sure there's no burrs left in it, and go from there.
All right, Phantom Corsair writes, "Hi, Bob. Got a few questions regarding AA trucks. Does anybody make parts for the 4-speed tranny or for the worm drive rear? I know one could get the AA 4-speed in a Model A car, the factory." I don't know what that means. But can you get those parts anymore? I don't have one yet, but I'd like to get a Model AA truck for my scrapping business to go alongside my 31 wide bed.
Okay, get hold of
Steve.
Steve at Burt's in Denver has a lot of used and new AA parts. In fact, his catalog has a whole section on it.
Yeah, he has now, the worm drive stuff there, yeah, too.
But if I was going to have a AA, I would get a Mitchell 2-speed to put in it. And Steve Mitchell is making a, everybody calls them overdrive, but they're not, they're a 2-speed.
Split rear end, yeah.
But it goes in the drive line. So that's your ultimate there. Then you won't have to worry about all the other stuff.
I've seen one in Willie's AA with the worm drive.
Right.
He has that, and I think it's like a 33% over or something right. like that.
Yeah, because the regular car has run in roughly 26, 28%. But the truck being slower already, they've upped the overdrive side to 33%.
Yep. So there you go. Daniel Simons writes, "My 31 Model A ran fine, then dies. I checked and I have no fire at the points. If I depress the ignition kill switch, it fires up. Is the switch your problem?" Sounds like he's got a pop-out switch. He says when he pushes it in, it fires
up. Like, yeah.
Yeah.
A pop-out switch could give you trouble. But if you get one that's working properly, they're good.
Solid.
Yeah, they're
until
solid.
Until it's not.
But the way the pop-out switch works is when the key is off, the switch is in, it shorts out that cable that goes all the way down to the distributor, shorts it to ground or to the side, positive side, ground side, whatever you want to call it. But anyway, it shorts that out so you can't start the car. And that was the reason for it, was theft-proof ignition. Mm-hmm. When you pop the switch out, it disconnects that ground and shifts the hot lead that's tied to the upper terminal there over to the cable and puts...
It goes down to the distributor, right?
Goes from the coil through the ignition switch and down to the distributor and makes the engine run. So if yours popping back and forth like that, running and not running, I would say you have a little trouble in that switch.
And then rebuilding or switch to a reproduction, I guess. And
well, it depends on how much you want to keep it original. I like the originals there. I like pop-outs. Most people don't, but I do.
I like them too.
But
although I change a lot of them out.
Yep.
Ben Evans, friend of the channel. Thanks, Ben. He writes, what is the ugliest original Model A body style, color, and pattern? What kind of car do you drive, Ben? That's it.
Is it?
That's it.
It's whichever one you got.
Yeah.
I think some of mine look ugly. I think some of them look fabulous. And others, I think, are the ultimate. To me, I like any of them.
You like the mail truck?
The mail truck is the ultimate.
Yeah.
And I think the business coupe with that porthole window is...
That's pretty.
That is a good one.
I like that one. That's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
I think the ugliest one, I think, believe it or not, I'm going to get a lot of flack for this.
Henry Ford's favorite.
Henry Ford's favorite body style, the special coupe. I don't know why, just having the roofing material go all the way back and then this big belt thing. I don't know why.
It just don't look right.
That doesn't look right. Sergeant Duckbutter writes, how about Ford Model AA trucks? There's a dually down the road for me for sale. It has two more sticks near the rear brake. Any ideas what they are? Sounds like a farm conversion.
Well, it sounds like to me you got one of those conversions that, they made them. They called them, what did they call them? One was called had a two-speed rear end in it.
Yeah, the Ruxtel or whatever.
Ruxtel or something like that they called it. And that sounds like what you got, some of those things. You might have one that's been converted from a dump truck and had a lever to pull it. There was all kind of those fancy different, you know, tow trucks. They had every kind of thing imaginable. In fact, there's a whole list of about 50 different bodies you could get on a truck.
Plus the dump and tilt bed and all that other. It could be any of those.
Plus,
I don't know.
Plus mail truck. They had a mail truck too, AA.
They didn't have the extra levers for a mail truck, did they?
No, they didn't. Had the regular.
I don't know. Maybe send a picture. That might help. Mm-hmm. Last question. Oh, it comes from Tina. It's from Model T. It was more of a statement. She says, wow, there's two hunks.
Yeah, us.
Us. We're hunks. Time to say thank you to some people and some new super donors of the channel. Jerry Valheim, thank you so much for being a super donor. Jeremy Denton, thanks for becoming a super donor. Steve Leck, a multiple time super donor. Thank you, Steve. Jeff Crummy, also a multiple time super donor. Thank you, Jeff. New super donor, J. Kenneth Griffin. Thank you so much. And Edward Cobble. Thank you so much. And if you want to know where your donations are going, the new Terry Burt's engines are pretty much where they're going. Also, thanks to Hastings Siegfried. Thank you so much. Bill Mueller, Dale Parsons, Jeremy Latsko, and Warren Ramsey, and we have three monthly donors now that donate every month, religiously without fail. Martin Simon just signed on. Thank you, Martin Simon. Ben Evans, we just made fun of Ben, saying his car is ugly. And Replications Company, thank you so much for watching these videos. Lots more coming up. If we get 100,000 subscribers, we're gonna go live. We'll take phone calls live. How's that? That'll be fun.
And that won't be long. It sounds the rate is going.
Oh, man. It is picking up quick. Thank you, everyone, so much for helping to become part of this community, part of this. It's not just a YouTube channel. This is a Model A community, and we all help each other. And nothing like this has happened before now. And now Mofka signed on, and we're working with them doing the ModelAtechquestions@gmail.com and helping so many more people now than ever before. So this is really exploding. I never saw it happening like this, but it really has. So part of that is because of you and your work.
And you.
It's all mostly them. Yeah, a little bit you. I almost had nothing to do with it.
No.
I'm the guy who owns the iPhone that they record these on. So thank you so
He's
much.
He's the one that edits it, too. I don't edit nothing.
You have to do all the editing. Right down here is the subscribe button. Make sure you click on that. If it's red, you haven't subscribed yet. Click on it. If it's gray, you're already subscribed. You're good to go. Thank you so much. We'll catch you on the next video.
Thanks. See ya.